Hi, this is Paul Kaiser for goodlearning.com. Let's talk about the different color modes that you're going to encounter when you're working with digital images. The color mode you use determines which colors you'll be able to work with in the image. It determines how those colors are stored, and it also determines how you'll be able to manipulate those colors. What we're looking at here is our subject for this tutorial, a tomato image, and it's in RGB format. Right now, that's our color mode. RGB stands for red, green, blue. That's because the image is made up of three different color channels: the red channel, green channel, and the blue channel. Most of the time, you're going to work with RGB images that are called 24-bit RGB images. That's because each of these three channels contains 8 bits of information. There's 8 bits on the red, 8 on the green, 8 on the blue. 8 bits is enough to store up to 256 different numbers. So there's in here, we can have 256 different levels of red in any of these pixels. It can be all the way red, or it can be no red at all, which is completely black. Same thing for the green, 256 levels of green and 256 levels of blue. So when we take the 8 bits on these three channels, add them up, we have a 24-bit image. RGB is one of the best formats to work in when you're editing for the web. Oftentimes, it's what is also used when editing photographs, though there are some other formats that professionals use. Let's have a look real quick at another color mode you may have seen but not understood. This is the same subject, but it's in CMYK color mode. That stands for cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. Each of these channels, just like in the RGB image, stores 8 bits of information most of the time. So there are 256 levels of cyan, of magenta, of yellow, and black. CMYK mode is here for color printing, not really used for web images or photo prints. When this image is output to be printed on, say, a four-color press, it will be output to different film pieces or printing plates or printing drums. There'll be one output for cyan, one output for magenta, one for yellow, one for black. There'll be 4 different pieces of output that are combined together with different colors of ink to get your four full color image. A word of caution, working with cyan, magenta, yellow, black, CMYK, this is really for printing professionals. They really understand what cyan, magenta, yellow, what the different intensities do to an image. If you're working with a professional service bureau or printer, you really shouldn't have to worry about CMYK. You should be doing your work in RGB, and based on the equipment the printer or prepress house has, they are going to color separate your RGB images into CMYK that is best suited, again, for their output equipment. It has to do with something we'll discuss later called dot gain and different things like that that are very specific to the equipment they use. If you work with a prepress bureau or a print shop that tells you to do the CMYK separation, you probably ought to think about getting a different print provider. Well, now let's have a look at another and the last of the color modes that actually show us colors. Here, what we're looking at is an index color image. Well, what is an index color image? Well, an example is a GIF file. It stores an index of colors, and so does an 8-bit PNG, portable network graphic file. But what it really does is, when you convert an image into index color format, it saves a table of all the colors that can be seen in that image. In this case, it's an 8-bit indexed image. So there's 256 colors total in this image. That's it. When you create the indexed image, your software is going to do the best it can at picking out the colors that really matter. There's not a whole lot of blue in this image, so if we were to look at the index color table, you're not really going to find blues. You're going to find reds, oranges, greens, and maybe a few yellows. The purpose of index color images is to try to cut down on your file size. An image that only has to store 256 colors instead of, 16,000 colors, well, it's not going to have as much information to store or to transmit over the wire, such as the internet. In Photoshop, if we want to, we can have a look at the indexed color table. What you see here, all these squares, these are the colors. This is the index, the color index. These are the colors that are defined for this image. Again, you don't really see any bright blues or even many yellows now that you mention it. Well, let's get done with the color images and have a look at the same image, but this is what we call grayscale. Now, I'm not going to call this black and white because it's not really black and white. It's grayscale. That is, we have one channel and it's 8 bits of information, which means it can store 256 different levels. Okay, but again, it's only one channel. So it just defines a black, or a level of black, which we'll call gray. So I can go all the way from completely black to completely white and all these levels in between. Again, it's 8-bit in this case, so there are 256 different levels of gray that can make up my image. Now again, some of you might have called this a black and white image. Let's go and show a couple of examples of truly black and white images. Now a black and white image is really only one bit. That is, it's either white or it's black, and that's it. Those are the only two colors that can be represented in a black and white, or what we call bitmap color mode image. Most fax machines are only capable of bitmap images. What we see here is the tomato image, and you can still tell it's a tomato, but how did we do this if we only have black or white to work with? Well, this version you see here, when I converted from grayscale to black and white, I told it to use a process called halftoning. Halftoning has a regular series of dots called halftone dots placed across the image. And then, based on how dark the image is in that area, the dot will be larger or smaller. And these light areas here, the halftone dots, they're always there in the regular pattern, but they're very small. Here where it's darker, the halftone dots are larger. That results in an optical illusion of different levels of black and white, different levels of gray, even though it's really only looking at black or white. You could print this out on a black and white laser printer, and it's still going to look like it has different levels of gray. Let's look at another way. So I would argue this looks a little bit better. Again, it's our tomato image. We started out in grayscale, and then we said, let's go to black and white, or bitmap color mode. Here, there's not a regular pattern of halftone dots. What we've done here is it uses dots that are all the same size, but it places them with a different frequency, different number of dots based on how dark the image is in that area. Here, where it's dark, we have many, many of those dots. Again, they're all the same size, but there's many of them crammed together. Here, where it's lighter, we've spaced out the dots so that it looks a lot lighter in the image overall. We still get this optical illusion of different shades of gray, even though we're only working with black or white. Now, again, you could print this out to a laser printer, and it's still going to look like a nice image. I hope this tutorial has helped you understand some of the different color modes you have available in your image editing program.